find me with the promise, dancing where you prophesy. Still shout. Welcome to our service today. I am so glad that you have tuned in. Whether you are a part of our congregation here at Mississauga Victory Church, or you just happen to stop by, or you're a regular listener to our service, I want to say welcome. We are glad that you are here. And today I have a special word for you, and I trust that you're going to be encouraged by it. But let me say, if you are in Northwest Mississauga or the surrounding area, Georgetown, Milton, Brampton, or even Oakville, I want to encourage you to join us for our service in-house. We meet at 2900 Argentia Road, and that is at the northwest end of Mississauga by Winston Churchill and the 401. As a matter of fact, I can see the 401 from our parking lot. So I want to invite you to join us 12:30 p.m. each Sunday for our service. Well, we are going to enter into worship and declare that our God is awesome. And so let me pray and we'll enter in. You know, I want to say, wherever you are watching this from, you could be in your bedroom, in your kitchen, in your car perhaps. I want for you just to set aside every distraction and enter into worship with us. Raise your hands, stand, whatever is comfortable for you. We are just glad that you're here and we're going to worship Jesus together. Let me pray. Father, I thank you today for your goodness. Lord, for your love and kindness and for your grace, for your tender mercies, God. Father, I pray for each person watching this, that you would meet with them right where they're at, that you would reveal your Son, Jesus Christ, that you would pour out your love. Daddy, we love to praise you. And as we enter into your presence, I thank you, God, for your presence in homes, Lord, in cars, wherever people are watching. We give you praise today. In Jesus' name, amen. Let's enter in together.
Darkness, you shine. Out of the ashes, we rise. There's no one like you, none like you. Our God is greater, our God is stronger. God, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer.
Our God is greater.
Bless the Lord, oh my soul. Oh my soul. Worship his holy name. Sing like never before. Oh my soul. I worship your holy name. The sun comes up. It's a new day dawning. It's time to sing your song again. Whatever may pass and whatever lies before me, let me be singing when the evening comes. Bless the Lord, oh my soul. Oh my soul. Worship his holy. Your holy name. You're rich in love and you're slow to anger. Your name is great and your heart is kind. For all your goodness I will keep on singing. 10,000 reasons for my heart to find. So bless the Lord, oh my soul. Oh my soul. Worship his holy name. Sing like worship your holy name. Bless you, time has come. Still my soul will sing your praise unending. 10,000 years and then forevermore. Forevermore. Bless the Lord, oh my soul. Oh my soul. Worship his holy name. Sing like never before. Oh my soul, I worship your holy name. Come on, bless the Lord, oh my soul. Oh my soul, worship his holy name. Worship your holy name, Lord, I worship your holy name. Sing like never. Worship your holy name. worship your holy name. Worship your holy
precious Lord Jesus, treasure of mine. Oh, what a privilege to be your delight.
This is my story. It's the song that I'll raise.
your name is great.
So good to worship God, isn't it? And He is the one who satisfies the longing in our soul. Nothing else will do. And so we give God thanks and praise for that. For our offering today, and let me just say thank you so much, MVC, for your faithful giving. You know, in our life groups, we're reading through Matthew, and one of the scripture verses that, you know, we had to read a couple weeks back, for me anyways, I'm a couple weeks ahead of the group, is, you know, in Matthew chapter 3, the Lord's shepherd. No, that's wrong. When was it that I shared the Lord is my shepherd? That's Matthew chapter 6, isn't it? No, Psalm 23. Oh, Father. Anyways, I guess I'm starting over, right? All right, just count myself down. 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. It is so good to worship God. And there is something about worship and turning our eyes fully, wholly onto God that just refreshes and strengthens us. And, you know, as the song says, nothing else will do. Nothing else can satisfy our hearts and fill us with such joy and peace as the presence of God. So I want to encourage you always to let worship be center, be your focus throughout your day. We're going to receive our offering for today. A couple weeks back for our reading in our life group, you know, the manual that we're doing, we had to look at Psalm 23. And as I read this, you know, we're supposed to ask God, you know, what do you want me to see in this verse? And it's such a popular passage that we know it so well that often we can read right through the beauty and the power of it. Well, the first verse jumped out at me and it says, the Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. And I know that you know that and you've probably memorized it for years. But I want for you to think about the power that there is in that verse. And the key word for me is the Lord is my, Marcia Smith, the Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. It speaks to us about the character of God. It speaks to us as to how He provides, how much He loves, how much, you know, my needs are taken care of. because God is my shepherd, and I want to say that he is your shepherd today. In the midst of a pandemic, amen, where finances are tight for so many people, I want for you to hear, the Lord is your shepherd, your shepherd. He will guide, he will counsel, he will instruct, he will direct you. So I want to encourage you to grab a hold of that verse, especially regarding your finances in the midst of this pandemic. Amen. And stand on this beautiful promise of God. Let me bless you now. Father, in the name of Jesus, we thank you for your word. Lord, that you are our shepherd. Father, is all that we need. I pray for a revelation for your people. I pray, God, that we would be so strengthened and encouraged by this verse. We've said it so many times, but I pray that we will see it afresh today. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you for your faithful giving to give to our church. As always, the easiest way is by Interact, and you can send an email transfer to donate@mississaugavictory.ca. donate@mississaugavictory.ca. That information is in the description of this video. Also, you may go to our website and use PayPal that way. Just go to mississaugavictory.ca. That's mississaugavictory.ca, and you'll see all the information there. That too is in the description of this video. I don't have much in terms of announcements for you this week. We're waiting on a couple of dates to finalize before I bring you some of the new things happening at our church. But I want to remind everyone, life groups are on Tuesdays or on Wednesdays. And we have two awesome groups going. I look forward to them each week. And so it's at 7 p.m. on Zoom. If you have not yet joined, it's not too late. You would have received MVC, all the material in your email. And even if you're not a part of the group, I strongly encourage you to go through the workbook with us. Amen. And so let's jump into the word for today. The fall of 1987 was my first encounter, true encounter with the Word of God. Yes, as a little girl growing up in Jamaica, went to church twice on Sunday and I don't know how many times during the week, and I would have heard the preaching of the Word. But I want to share with you my encounter with the Word that began the process of changing my life. Fall 1987. This would have been, I would say, middle of November to December, and then earlier on into 1988. At this point in my life, I was discharged from the hospital. I believe it was the week before that we had buried my mother, and you know the story very well. My testimony is online. My stepfather shot and killed my mother and then shot me in both arms, and I was in hospital for 3 weeks. And so when I came out of the hospital, I still had both casts on my arm. I think by this time they were half a cast, but I still needed to be fed, to be bathed, to be dressed, because my arms were, you know, they were quite weak, let's put it that way. And no, I think I was wearing just braces on my arm at this point. And my aunt had come from Jamaica, and she was taking care of me. And I remember that after I came out of the hospital, I went to stay with my uncle and his family. And my grandparents were there, and the house was quite full. But I remember my aunt, you know, we were around the same age, and she would read the Bible, and wherever she was reading the Bible, I would say to her, "Can you read it out loud? Whatever you're reading, just read it out loud." I want for you to imagine my emotional state and not just my physical state. Yes, I was walking around, needed to be fed, bathed, and all of that. You know, I think I was slowly starting to be able to feed myself, and that in itself would take me probably an hour to have a meal. Emotionally, I was a wreck, as you can imagine, trying to imagine my life without my mother and moving on from this place. Well, wherever my aunt was reading the Bible, I'd sit beside her and I would say, "Can you read it out loud?" And I recall perhaps she would read the Psalm, New Testament. I don't even remember. But I distinctly remember not understanding a lot of what she read. Didn't know what it was about. But I clearly remember that whenever she read out loud the scriptures to me, it would do something on the inside. It was just an overwhelming comfort and peace. That's probably the word that I felt when she would read the word out loud. That experience took me on a journey of falling in love with the Word of God and longing for the Word of God and desiring to be wherever the Word of God is being preached and taught. And so that's kept me on the journey. And it would give me this passion for the Word. I wish I could tell you that my passion for the Word had remained constant and hot and fervent over these past 30-something years. But there are times where it waned. But there are times where it's been boiling hot. I want to say, and I want to ask you today, where are you with the Word of God? Is it hot and passionate in your heart? Do you run to it? Does it call you when you wake up in the morning? Is it the first thing that you think, I've got to get into the Word? Or perhaps when you are finished work and, you know, or before you go to bed, is there a yearning? Is there a desire? Is there a fervency for the Word? Do you think about the Word of God during the day? Perhaps you see a billboard or something on television and it brings the Word back to you. Is it hot and passionate in your heart? And if it's not hot and passionate in your heart, what happened? And today we want to look at what happens when people become hot and passionate about the Word, when they long for the Word. We're going to take a look at this today, and we're going to look at the result of it. But I want to propose to you today that one of the greatest need of Christians in North America, specifically Christians in Canada, the greatest need is a renewed fervency and passion and love for the Word of God. And I hope that you will see that one of the things that we are missing most in our Christian walk is this fervency and this desire for the Word. I want for you to look with me in the book of Nehemiah, and we're going to look at chapter 8. But let me take a moment and give you a background of what we are about to read. The Jewish people are in the post-exilic period. They had been in captivity in Babylon for 70 years. And now they are returning to Jerusalem, and the walls are broken down. The city is in a deplorable condition. And it's around B.C. 445, and the Jews have arrived, and someone had come to Nehemiah, who's serving in the king's court, and told him about the state of the city of Jerusalem. And as you read in the beginning chapters of the book of Nehemiah, you see how Nehemiah's heart was just broken when he heard about the state of this city, his beloved city. And so he went before the king with, you know, fasting and prayer, and he asked the king for permission to return to the city of Jerusalem to help rebuild the walls. And he boldly even asked for supplies to rebuild the wall. And by God's grace, he was given permission and money, the resources that he would need. And even a traveling escort to rebuild this wall. And in Nehemiah chapters 1 verse 7, we see Nehemiah was able to encourage and cast the vision for the people to rebuild this wall. And though they encountered so many opposition, it got to the place where they were building, you know, had their building material in one hand, and they had to have a spear in the other because they faced so much opposition. They finished the wall in record time. Nehemiah 7 verse 1 says, after the wall had been rebuilt and I had set the doors in place, the gatekeepers, the musicians, and the Levites were appointed. And then in further on in chapter 7, we learn that these people gave generously towards the work. It says in verse 70, some of the heads of the families contributed to the work. The governor gave to the treasury 1,000 darics of gold, 50 bowls, and 530 garments for the priest. Some of the heads of the families gave to the treasury for the work 20,000 darics of gold and 2,200 minas of silver. The total given by the rest of the people were 20,000 darics of gold and 2,000 minas of silver and 67 garments for the priest. They had done this great work. They were financially resourced to, for the priesthood and money to do what was needed. But in the midst of it, something was missing. You can just imagine the excitement because they accomplished such a great work in a short period of time. But something was missing. Outwardly, the work was done, but inwardly, a work needed to be done. And so we're going to take a look at what was missing for the people. You see, there was a hunger for the Jewish people, and there was a hunger for the Word of God. And I want to say to us, you know, that one of our greatest need right now is for a hunger for the Word. Look in Nehemiah 8, verse 1. It says, all the people came together as one in the square before the water gate. They told Ezra, the teacher of the law, to bring out the book of the law of Moses, which the Lord had commanded Israel. You see, the leadership also later on in this chapter would call for the word of the Lord. The people called for the word. I want for you to see it. They went to Ezra. He's the priest. He's the teacher to bring out the book of the law. Amen. And then the leaders in verse 13 also said the same thing. On the second day of the month, the heads of all the families, along with the priests and the Levites, gathered around Ezra, the teacher, to give attention to the word of the Lord. Let me continue on in verse 2. It says, so on the first day of the seventh month, Ezra the priest brought the law before the assembly, which was made up of men and women and all who were able to understand. He read aloud from daybreak till noon. As he faced the square before the water gate in the presence of the men, women, and others who could understand. And all the people listened attentively to the law. I want for you to watch this. Verse 3. Ezra read from the word of God from daybreak, early morning, until noon, which meaning that these people stood and listened to the word of God, amen, not just listened casually. The Bible specifically said they listened attentively for about 6 hours. I want for you to put yourself in the scripture and imagine what that must have been like for these people. What was happening in their hearts? What caused them to stood attentively and just hear the word of God being read, being taught to them for 6 hours? Many times people think, you know, I usually preach for around 40 minutes. Oh, my stars, that is so long. But I want for you to imagine 6 hours, what was happening, what caused this. You see, these people had gone 70 years in captivity in Babylon. They had not gathered together like this to hear the word of the Lord. And I want for you to keep in mind that your ordinary citizens did not have the book of the law. Amen? They didn't have copies of it. This would be reserved for the priest. Many of these people who had been born in captivity had probably just heard the word through their parents, just heard bits of the stories and the recount of what God had done in Genesis, in Exodus, in Leviticus, and in Numbers. Many of those now, you know, are older, those 70 years and older, there would have been a longing in their hearts to hear the word. It would have been like water, amen, to their soul. There is so much wrapped up in the word. It was their history. It was their culture. It spoke of their destiny. It spoke of why they were called. It spoke of why they went into captivity. It spoke of what God was about to do in the future. You see, the word would have been in Hebrew, and many of these people now had been in Babylonian captivity, and they would have spoken Chaldee. So part of, you know, Ezra's role and the other priest, amen, was to help them to understand, to translate from Hebrew to Chaldee, amen. Not only was the word of God needed to be translated, they needed to understand what they are reading. And so it was important for Ezra and the teachers to expound the word of God to them. Something moved them so much that they stood for 6 hours to hear the life-giving, the life-changing, powerful, transformative word of God. Out hearing the word of God being read to them, amen, that ministered to their soul. That I want for you to think about, men, women, teenagers, children, stood attentively to hear the word of the Lord. I want to say that our greatest need right now, amen, is for the word of God and for that word of God to minister to our souls. And unfortunately, we do not recognize that our need is for the word. We may think that we've got a financial need, amen? And yes, in the natural you do, but I want to say to you that the answer to your financial problem or your lack of finances is found in the word, amen? That the solution to the relationship issues that we struggle with from time to time, it's in the word. Issues with the children, amen? It's in the word. All that we need is in the word of God. And so many times we look to other sources and we look for other things, amen, to fill the longing in our soul. But I want to tell you that it's the word of God. Many of you know that, you know, if you see me, I usually have a bottle of water with me, right? I've got so many water bottles at home. And how I started being able to drink water, I never used to like water, or even just to drink it. Now I can easily drink in the summer, you know, two liters of water a day and sometimes more. In the wintertime, it's usually probably around a liter to 1,500, or 1.5 liters. But how it all started was somebody, I read somewhere that many times we are walking around dehydrated and we don't recognize it. Our body is giving us the signals that we are thirsty, but rather than recognize it as a thirst signal the body is giving us, we may go and eat something or, you know, we walk away from it. And so, you know, that signal gets less and less and less. And one of the things that was recommended was that just take water with you. Have a glass of water with you on your desk. So I started doing that. I just started carrying a bottle with me. And as I began to sip, oh my stars, I would finish that bottle of water in no time. I didn't used to recognize how thirsty I was. And I want to say likewise, many Christians do not recognize how thirsty you are for the word. Because we may go and fill that hunger in our souls with something else. Amen? All that we need is in the word of God. If it's wisdom that you need, Psalm 119 says, you through your commandments make me wiser than my enemies, for they are ever with me. Verse 99 says, I have more understanding than all my teachers, for your testimonies are my meditation. If it's peace that you need, amen? Psalm 119, 165 says, great peace have those who love your law and nothing can make them stumble. If it's joy that you need, Jesus says, these things I have spoken to you, that my joy may remain in you and that your joy may be full. Why do we have so many Christians who feel that they do, you know, that they're not walking in joy? I want to say to you that the word of God is your joy giver. It's your peace giver. It's your wisdom giver. Amen. It's your counselor. It is your guide. It is your strength. It is all that you need. But many times we walk away and we look for something else. amen, to fill and to satisfy that longing in our soul. One of the things I think that has happened to us in North America is that we have lost reverence for the Word. We have the Word of God in so many formats. Amen? But we somehow, I think, we have lost reverence for the Word. Look with me in Nehemiah 8, verse 4. And, you know, look at what happened to the Jews when they are hearing the Word being read to them that day. It says, Ezra, the teacher of the law, stood on a high wooden platform built for the occasion. Beside him on his right hand stood Mattitha, Shema, Ananiah, Uriah, Hilkiah, Masiah, and on his left was Pediah, Mishael, Malkijah, Hashem, Hashbadana, Zechariah, and Meshulam. Try saying all that real fast. Verse 5, Ezra opened the book. All the people could see him because he was standing above them. So here, just use your imagination. Thousands of people, they're here. They initiated the priest to bring the word of God and to read it to them. Amen? And the priest is standing now on this platform to the right. You know, there are other, priests with him, other teachers. On his left, there are other teachers. Look what happened. It says, as he opened it, what? The book of the law. As he opened it, the people stood up in reverence for what is about to happen. It says, verse 6, Ezra praised the Lord, the great God. And all the people lifted their hands and responded, amen, amen. Then they bowed down and worshiped the Lord with their faces to the ground. Oh, the word of God is being read. And as the word of God, the eternal, awesome, omnipotent word of God is read, the people cried out, amen, so let it be. Then they bowed down and they worshiped God. They heard the story, amen, of how God brought them out of Egypt, brought their ancestors out of Egypt. Amen. They heard of the miracles of what God did. They heard his name being proclaimed. Amen. And they bowed down and worshiped. They bowed down and worshiped. In verse 8, it says, this is all the priests, the Levites, they read from the book of the law of God, making it clear and giving the meaning so that the people understood what was being read. Then Nehemiah the governor, Ezra the priest and teacher of the law, and the Levites who were instructing the people said to them all, this day is holy to the Lord your God. Do not mourn or weep. For all the people had been weeping as they listened to the words of the law. Listen, their souls were so hungry for the word of God. They stood up when the word was being read. Amen. They worshiped when they heard the word. And then the Bible said they began to weep as they listened to the words of the law. I want to say they had such a holy reverence for the word of God. They had such an awe for the word. They saw it for what it was, the living word of God. And it became so powerful to them. Church, could it be that we have lost our reverence for the Word of God? Could it be that we are treating the Word of God as an ordinary thing, not as holy and as life-giving as it truly is? Amen? The Bible says this, or Jesus says this about the word in John 6:63. The spirit gives life. The flesh counts for nothing. Jesus says, the words I have spoken to you, they are full of spirit and life. My stars, the word of God is alive. It is not just words on the page. It is the word spoken from the omnipotent God himself to give us guidance and direction. It is the word of God that transforms us. It is alive. Hebrews 4 verse 12, for the word of God is alive and active, sharper than any two-edged sword, penetrates even to divide in soul and spirit, joints and marrow. It judges the thoughts and intents of our hearts. The word of God is powerful. Amen. All God said to create the heavens and the earth is, let it be, let there be light. It is powerful. God spoke everything into existence. This is how powerful his word is. He spoke a word to my heart and he spoke a word to your heart. Amen. And grabbed you out of the kingdom of darkness and planted us into the kingdom of his son. His word strengthened us and picked us up, dusted us off. His word declares us as righteous and holy. His word is life-giving. Have you had an encounter with the word of God? Amen. If you know it to be so, I want to encourage you. Just write chat in the comment section here on YouTube. In North America, here in Canada, we have free access to the word of God. Amen. On my tablet, I don't know how many translations I can access it. You know, it's countless. It's free. We can go to the internet. But I think that we have lost our awe. We have lost reverence for the word of God. There is a study done in 2013, and it was published in 2014. It's called the Canadian Bible Engagement Study, and I'm glad this was done because a lot of times you go on the internet and you try to find stats. It's American. But this was a study done on 4,500 Canadians. And the conclusion is that the majority of Canadians who identify themselves as Christian read the Bible either never or seldom. Weekly Bible reading in Canada has fallen by half since 1996. Only 5% of Christians read their Bible daily. 5%. One in seven Canadian Christians read their Bible once a week. That's 14%. One in seven read their Bible once a week. Someone asked in our Bible study a while back, you know, Pastor, why doesn't the church in North America, why are we not seeing the miracles? Why are we not seeing the strength of the church as we did in the book of Acts? Can I say to us, you know, perhaps this is the reason, or one of the reasons. We have lost our passion and reverence for the word of God. We have lost our hunger for the word of God. We see one of the reasons why the church was so strong in the book of Acts. It says that they steadfastly were in the apostles' teaching. Amen? They were hotly pursuing it. But here we are in North America with an abundance of the living, active, life-giving word of God. And you know what? We pay very little attention to it. I'm going to show you a little video of, it's just 1 minute, of some Chinese Christians receiving a Bible for the first time. I want for you to see the expression on their face. For many years, Bibles were smuggled in to China in order for them to have their own scripture. And this is on the internet. And I just want to let you know that the video is a little bit blurry. This was how it was filmed. But take a look at how these Chinese Christians responded to how, you know, receiving the word of God.
Give me Jesus. Give me
Jesus.
Sad, Lord. You know, something to that effect. And this passage in Amos 8, verse 11, I think is very sad. It says, "The days are coming, declares the sovereign Lord, when I will send a famine through the land, not a famine of food or a thirst for water, but a famine of hearing the words of the Lord." It says in verse 12, "People will stagger from sea to sea and wander from north to east, searching for the word of the Lord, but they will not find it." I have to admit that even now, as I was preparing this message, tears came to my eyes as I read this word. And I said, "God, I can't imagine that upon the earth where there would be a famine, Lord, for not having the word of God." And it speaks to us, church, how much we ought to have the word of God hot and passionate in our hearts. You see, the reason why I'm doing this message, I shared with you at our fall launch that the four areas that God gave me as we're coming towards the tail end of this pandemic is that, you know, number one, we ought to refocus on our mission, why we're here, why we're doing what we are doing, amen, and it is to have the mission of God to see lost souls saved. And these are in no particular order. We looked for 4 weeks on the second thing that God gave me, reconnect our fellowship, and this is so important. And we've just completed our second week of our life groups, and I've been so blessed and encouraged by it. I look forward to them each week. Amen. And reignite our love for God. We haven't covered that yet. And this one that we're doing, rekindle our passion for the word. Amen. And as I prepare, I'm recognizing how important this is. How important it is for our church, how important it is for you individually to hide the word of God in our heart. Amen. A few years ago, when I was living in Calgary, I had the privilege and the honor of going to a retreat for pastors that was held by the Billy Graham Association. Oh, it was such a blessing. When I was in Calgary, one of the key speakers was Cliff Barrows. And here are a couple pictures of him up on the screen. And if you recall, Cliff Barrows traveled with Billy Graham for many, many years. He was Billy Graham's music director. He was also a minister and preacher of the word, but God called him to join Billy Graham and to support Billy Graham's ministry. And there's a couple pictures there, as I mentioned. And one of the things that blessed me at this conference was when he spoke. I can think of two occasions, you know, there's probably others, but I think of two, where I hear the word of God being preached and I freeze, unable to be take notes, and I'm usually writing as I hear someone preach the word. And one of the occasions, this is one of the occasions where I just stood with my mouth open, just in awe. The one occasion was hearing Dr. Fuchsia Pickett preach and go on the internet, listen to her messages. But this particular occasion, Cliff Barrows preached, and he was led to the stage because at this point, you know, he must have been in his 80s because he died, I think, at the age of 93 a few years ago. And he was led to the stage and he let us know that he had lost most of his sight. But he talked about his love for the Word and he talked about his wife reading the Word to him. But what was so awesome about this man preaching, I don't remember how long he preached, 45 minutes, an hour, it didn't matter. But this man preached the Word of God just from memory. And I am telling you that he quoted the Word of God seamlessly. It just flowed out of him, just flowed out of him. Not quoting scriptures like I do, you know, paraphrasing or a bit here, a bit there. My struggle is that I read New King James for many years and then I switched to New International. And so I often get the quotations mixed up. But the Word of God just flowed out of this man as he stood and ministered, just flowed out as he preached the Word. Amen. It was so powerful. He talked about his love for the Word and how that made such a difference in his life, memorizing scripture. And we would think that's just for children, but church, I got to tell you, we've got to get back to basics. Amen. This is how we grow. This is how we flourish. This is how we are strengthened as believers. It's the Word. And today I am praying, amen, that God would rekindle, amen, or for some of us, if you've never had it, give us a fresh fire in our hearts for the Word. And so I ask you today, how is your passion for the Word of God? Is it hot and fervent, or has it gone lukewarm, has that dim gone out? Let me read you a couple of scriptures from Psalm 119, 97. The psalmist says, how I love your law. It is my meditation all day. Verse 103, my favorite. How sweet are your words, O Lord, sweeter than honey to my mouth. Verse 127, therefore I love your commandments more than gold. Yes, more than fine gold. Can you imagine that? Verse 136 says, rivers of water run down from my eyes because men do not love your law. Can you hear the psalmist's passion and fervency for the Word? Verse 88, pray this. He says, revive me according to your loving kindness so that I may keep the testimony of your mouth. Would you pray that, church? Would you ask God for this passion for his Word? Would you ask him to rekindle a passion for his Word? Amen? I have a challenge for you today. And the challenge is this, and I want to hear about it if you do this. I'm going to send you a text and ask you during the week if you've done this. I'm going to ask you to set aside half an hour, 45 minutes, whatever point this week. Yes, I know you're doing your life group. This is an addition. Amen. Or perhaps on the day, you know, that you have off from your readings, read Psalm 119. Read Psalm 119. It is so powerful. Whenever I find my passion for the Word waning, amen, I go and I sit in Psalm 119. It's 174 verses or 176 verses, I believe. Amen. And I know that it sounds like a lot, but it's a quick, easy read. And I want for you to get your highlighter, whether on your phone, tablet, computer, or a paper Bible, and highlight the key words in it for you. This is such a powerful psalm. If you ask me what my favorite psalm is, it's this. And whenever I find that passion waning, where I'm not jumping up and down for the Word of God, I go and I sit in Psalm 119. You may find that long to read and, you know, break it up into 2 days. But it's written to be read in its entirety. Amen. Don't take more than 2 days reading this. Set aside whatever you have to do. Would you believe that Billy Graham's mother memorized this entire psalm? And when she was ill and dying, she was able to quote it in its entirety. And would you pray through it? Meditate on it. Amen? Asking God to rekindle or kindle afresh his word in your heart. I will tell you that it is life-changing. We have gotten so much to doing life on our own, amen, and leaving the word of God aside. We get up and we run throughout, you know, our day from one thing to the next, neglecting the word that would give us all the wisdom that we need, give us all the strength that we need, give us the counsel that we need, give us the strength that we need. It is not just words on a page. It is the breath of God for you and for me. And so I want for you to begin to imagine, what would your life be like when it's the word of God is so hot and passionate? What would it be like that when the wake up in the morning, one of the first things you want to turn to is the word? Or when you get home from work or before you go to bed at night, you go, oh my God, Lord, I haven't spent enough time in your word. Let me get my Bible. Oh, this is how God wants us to approach the word. Where husbands will grab a hold of wives and your children and say, let us read the word of God together. Amen. With reverence and with holiness. And single people, amen, a bunch of you can get together and read the word or read the word for yourself. Amen. It is so powerful now that on my tablet, amen, I can just hit that play button and I hear the word of God. If I'm cooking, amen, I could hit play and just hear the word of God. In my car, I have CDs, amen, of the entire New Testament on CD. And many times I even put aside a sermon or I put aside whatever it is I'm listening to on YouTube or even music and say, let me hear the scriptures. Amen. Let it feed my soul. I challenge you to see what God will do as the word of God is ignited. Jeremiah says, the word of God is like fire shut up in my bones. Oh God, I pray that the word of God would become fire in your belly. Can you imagine what our church would look like? Amen. If we have 50%, 10%, 100% of people fired up about the word. Amen. Can you imagine what the Church of Jesus Christ in Canada would be, where we go from just 1 in 7 Christians reading their Bible once a week to even half? Can you imagine how our nation would change when the people of God get the Word of God on the inside of them? The sky is the limit to what God would do. Because it's by his word that everything changes. The world was created by his word. Amen. Every word that was given is for our instruction. How many marriages would be healed? How many people would be rescued out of the kingdom of darkness? Jesus gives us the mandate, go into all the world and preach the gospel. Well, how can we preach the gospel when it's not on the inside of us? Amen. We need to get back to reverence in the word of God, where we see it as holy and life-changing. There's so much in that passage of scripture, but I'm going to stop here and we'll pick it up again. Father, rekindle your word in our heart. Give us a passionate love for your word. God, that we can listen to it, even the parts that we don't understand. Father, I pray, God, that we would read the word until it ignites on the inside. Until a fire is birthed, God. Lord, we don't want to just nibble at the word. We don't want just the crumbs of the word. We want the fire of God burning in our hearts as we read the word. We want to experience what the writer of Psalm 119 wrote, where he says, tears run down my eyes when men do not obey your word. Father, we want to reverence it. We want to see that your word is holy, that it is powerful, that it is life. Help us, Lord. And Father, forgive us for being so casual about your word. Forgive us for not reading, for not meditating, for not sinking into your word. God, would you ignite a passion in our hearts in Mississauga Victory Church? Father, would you do that in Jesus' name? And God, that your church is strengthened in the name of Jesus. Amen and amen. God bless you. God bless you. Amen. I pray that you would meditate in this word. This is how God is building his church. This is one of the ways. Amen. We're going to close off with our theme song for this season. God is building his church. We don't want to be weak. We don't want to be tepid. We don't want to be lukewarm. We want to be hot, fervent for God. And one of the ways that God ignites it is by his word. God bless you. I want to encourage you to write comments in the chat. I want to encourage you next week, invite someone to join us for the word. And if you have not yet subscribed to the channel, just hit subscribe. And remember to hit that thumbs up button. You know what? The more you do it, the more YouTube allows more people to see the video, the more it gets circulated. So it's very important, church. Just another way of getting the word out. So I love you. Amen. I long to see you. If you have not yet returned to the house of the Lord, amen. We long to see you. God bless you. Have an awesome week. By his great power, let the word of God be stirred up in your heart. In Jesus' name. See you next week.
Chief cornerstone, no other foundation can we build upon. Not philosophy, nor the wisdom of man, for all other ground is sinking sand. Upon
church, build your church, build it from the ground up. We're your church, build your church, build your church, build it from the ground up. It's your church, build your church.